Everything is coming our way. Hi, welcome. I'm Howie Walfish. This is The Mighty Power of Faith, sponsored by Pitbull Energy Drink. A little late start on today's episode. We wanted to get Carlos Santana, the musical icon and legend, singing one of my favorite songs. I've always talk about the power of suggestion being very powerful. And this is, if you're down, if you feel like, you know, you're up against it, this is a good song to listen to. Everything's coming our way. Everything is coming our way. The morning's calling. Walk with me unto the sun. I can't sing, so I won't, you know, torture you like that. But I would highly recommend to have that on your wake up to songs and in when you're in despair or down and out. Too much suicide, you know. I'm a comedian. I do stand-up comedy. More or less, I'm a professional comedic entertainer. A lot of guys do a lot more stand-up comedy than me. A lot of women, too. But I do stand-up comedy. I've got a new stand-up show coming. A live event we're going to be doing on Sundays right over where Victory and Western meet. Great place called Mambo's. It's going to be a lot of fun. But in that world of stand-up comedy in L.A. and outside of L.A., ever since Robin Williams killed himself, there's been, I don't know, four or five comedian suicides or accidental. I mean, I think one was a guy that, you know, just drank himself to death in the sense of he drank so much and he collapsed in the jacuzzi. And he died that way. So, believe me, what's behind that, there's despair behind that. Anyone that's drinking that heavily like that and you're in a jacuzzi, it's not because you're happy. That's my professional opinion, and I'm not a professional, but I'm a pretty intelligent fellow as far as I'm concerned. And who appointed me to come and speak to you about the mighty power of faith? You know, did God reach down from the heavens and touch my forehead? You know, did I get hit by a truck and I had an epiphany? No. It's just my life history, the things I've brought myself through and brought myself through. And, you know, faith pays off. And so I have this platform here, and I like to share it with anyone that's willing to listen, who's in, particularly people who are in, you know, difficult times. That's where I've been telling people for years, because I lived beyond my means for many years, made a lot of bad mistakes with money. And so people say, how's it going? And I've been telling people for years, I'm living on faith, and I have been, and it has paid off. And most recently, when I wasn't going to tell this, I wasn't going to post this on my Facebook page, but until it hit the airwaves, but I booked a commercial, a buyout commercial, okay? They pay you all at once, no residuals. And I'm telling this story because this was a great reinforcement of faith and then a shaking of faith. But I've decided to stay strong in my faith regardless. I got burned bad. And I'm also saying this to any actor that'll hear this, anybody in the entertainment business that'll hear this. When you go to those sets and they tell you to fill out your W-4, I am telling you, you want to put exempt from federal withholding. Exempt. Especially if it's a high-dig paying thing. Because what they did is, it was a $12,000 buyout. Normally, I would not discuss the money's earned. It's nobody's business, whatever. But I'm doing it to get it clear to anyone that might see this. If I can save one person from going through the grief I went through, it's worth my time here today. $12,000 buyout plus 20% to the agency. First of all, if you get a thing like that, if you book it, this was my second audition with this particular agency, and this agency came to me no less than by the hand of God, I will tell you, because I encountered a nut job on the Facebook. He went bananas on me. It's a long story. I wanted to understand why I was supposed to be on his podcast. I asked for four days ahead of time. I asked to reschedule. He went crazy. He said, I'll never work in this town again. He was deluded. I found out that he had mental health issues, which is not a big shock, here, again, being here in L.A. But not all podcast hosts have mental health issues. I do not have mental health issues. I'm pretty well adjusted, actually. However, I do get the despair and the depression, and that's where faith comes in also. But this guy led me to try to find out what I had just dealt with. And in doing that, I came across a mutual friend. And that mutual friend said, I've got somebody who knows the whole story with this guy. And that somebody was a guy named Robert. And Robert had spent 9 years in the military, 5 with the Marines, 4 with the Army Rangers. We talked on the phone. He's just a great guy. We hit it off. And he is a doer. He is constantly on the hustle, achieving, doing. He's a good influence to have in my life. He is partners with a woman named Chris, and the two of them are they're strong faith-based people, and I ask God every day to put the right people in my path. Well, that's how Robert explained to me about this nut job, that what he'd went through with him. It was unbelievable. You wouldn't believe it if I read the emails Robert showed me this guy sent to him. The point is, this big, huge negative, this nut job, led me to this guy, Robert. I'm not using full names, and Robert got me to the agency. The agency got me out once. I went to an audition. It was 10 seconds. Nothing happened. A month and a half later, maybe, I go to the audition. I get called back. I already knew what I was going to do to make them laugh. I'm playing a guy that's a salesman, and the couple buying the appliance is trying to finagle just paying me $20 a week or something. It's for Rent-A-Center. We're on hidden cameras in a Sears or something like that. And at the audition, I say, they said to improv, and so I go, listen, man, we got to do this the right way. If they catch me doing what you want to do, I'll get fired, and I got a miniature pony at home. And they cost a lot of money. And I did it a couple of different ways. But the director, you know, he got me. And I got booked. And it was awesome because it was in January. My birthday's on the 14th. And the woman who's the partner of my pal Robert, who I first met, she's the one who got to call me on Monday to say, this is my first time I ever talked to this lady. And she told me an amazing story about her history with ups and downs of money, and quite a testimony, and really lift my spirits. And she told me, you know, I wanted to be the one to call you and tell you you're on a veil. And it's shooting on the 14th, 15th, and 16th. Well, the 14th is my birthday, and I told her that. So an hour and a half, and now you're on a veil, and you're just like, this is when you really get in that old-time religion. God, dear God, please God. I try not to strike bargains with God. I'm just like, you know, you promised you'd do exceedingly abundantly above and beyond. You know, come on, God, come through. And an hour and a half later, I answer the phone. I see it's her number, and I just hear her go, happy birthday, Howie. And I know I've booked the commercial, and it's awesome. Because that money was much needed. And so first thing I learned, when a production company says they're going to pay your agent your fee plus 20% on top for the agency, you must contact the production company and say, please send two checks. One check for my agent, one check for me. The agent gets his 20% on top. There's no reason that should be on my check, but it was. The agent got one check for $14,400. The IRS treats that as if I earn that every day. This was an aberration. I don't earn $14,000 a day. $14,000 a day, 10 days is 140 grand, 150, almost 150. It's basically like $4.5 million, $5 million a year. That's what they're taxing me at. And without any loopholes, without my accountant doing anything, they put me in a 50% plus tax bracket. And when the check came to my agent for $14,400, when you took away the federal withholding and then took away the 20% that was on top and the agency gets 20% regardless, I thought I was getting a check for $7,500 to $9,000. I was going to be in good shape. I was going to be able to move. I was going to be able to get back on track. I got a check for $2,251 over one word, exempt. I didn't put exempt from federal withholding. I thought by putting a lot of dependents, 12 dependents, and I'll work this out at the end of the year with my accountant, I'd at least get most of my money. But that's not how it works. When you're at a certain level of earning, and wealthy people know this, of course, and they're prepared for it. But us schlubs, we're not prepared for it. I wasn't prepared for it. I don't know how I didn't know it. My pal's wife, who works in the intensive care, when I lamented to her about the story, she looked at me. She goes, what are you, 10? You don't know this? When I work overtime, Howie, I submit a different W-4 because they make a lot of money, those intensive care nurses. You know, 60, 80, 100, I don't know. They make good money. So to keep her money, she puts herself as exempt. And so I learned a very hard lesson, and I said, I'm going to go ahead and spread the word to all actors. Everybody works too hard. It's too hard on the hustle. It's too much of a good thing to book a commercial like that, and then you're just burned and buried. Don't get me wrong. $2,251 is great. It enabled me to give money back to some people that had helped me out. It enabled me to, you know, get a couple of things in order, whatever. But it ain't $9,000, you know. So the IRS stole my money. My accountant tells me you'll get it back in a refund check next year. But I don't really, I haven't filed in like 2 or 3 years. So whenever I file, I don't show a lot of money on the book. So who cares, you know? I'm an independent contractor, and I understand why wealthy people take full advantage of every write-off, every loophole, every everything, because the IRS is pure evil. I believe that's a And this isn't a religious show. This is just to try to get anyone who might come across it, who might be facing some hard times, to give them what was given me. To remember to stay in faith, that faith, no problem can, faith is bigger than any problem you're facing. There's no problem that faith cannot solve. That's what I was taught. And I've seen it work. So that, but I will say that I'm not here to preach against Satan. I'm just telling you that Satan is alive and well in the IRS. And the next presidential candidate that makes his or her primary platform the destruction of ISIS and the psychotic, barbaric, murderous terrorists, coupled along with the abolishment of the IRS, that's a landslide victory. That's my prediction. So I then had not quite a crisis of faith, but you do start to think after you put so much time into being, you know, in faith and telling people to have faith, however they see faith, however they perceive faith, Jesus, God, Moses, the Buddha, the universe, themselves, their dog, whatever it is, maybe really extremely confident people don't need to have faith. Maybe their only faith is in themselves. I don't know. But I do know that when you're seen your faith pay off, that you had a birthday miracle at the beginning of the new year, and then 30 days later, they paid on time, you get one-third of what you thought you were getting. You know, you had your money divided up of where it was going to go, where it had to go, and you don't got that money no more. I can't get my teeth completed. Like, you couldn't go to the eye doctor. People helped me out. I ran into some hard times, and I was not able to send them the money I wanted to send them. So what's left? What am I back to? I'm back to going, this faith stuff is a bunch of BS. It doesn't work. It's nonsense. Or like my muse told me, you know, be grateful for the money you got. You have to be grateful for the money you got and return to staying in faith. So something else is going to come along. And I'm going to have to believe that, because if I stop believing that, you're going to read about me on Facebook that you know, Howie decided to opt out because I've got $250,000 life insurance policy. And by the way, that's how I came to faith, is in such a strong way, is I had $250,000 life insurance policy. I owed so much money. I made so many mistakes that I just thought, you know, let me swallow the bottle of sleeping pills and go to sleep. And my life insurance policy will cover everybody. You know, my responsibilities will be met. I actually started thinking I'm worth more dead than alive. It's not, you know, I just have more money dead right now than alive. But $250,000, we're in LA. The truth is, if you believe you have talent, if you believe in your talent, and I know I have talent, I'm not bragging, I'm just saying, I know that I've booked 4 or 5 commercials on the second audition. It's just spread out over time. I know that I'm a character. I know that I could do really well on a reality show thing. That's why I do these podcasts. You never know who's watching, who's going to see, who's going to get it, that this guy, you know, belongs in front of cameras, whatever. The end result of getting in front of cameras that are actually on the TV, whether it's cable or network TV, $250,000, it's not that much money. It's not that much money. So that's what my life insurance policy is. And the question is, can I make that happen inside of a year or less? If I can leapfrog ahead, if I can spring forward, if I can get seen by the right people, if they'll buy my idea. Yes, it's LA. Anything can happen. In the meantime, what am I left with? It was a bad situation. First it was shock, then it was depression, and then you got to come back to. I thought last week I didn't come do the show. And this week and the week before, my guest just stayed over. I didn't do the faith show. This week, I wanted to be sure to do the faith show because one of my other favorite songs is You Only Get What You Give by New Radicals, and that helped me in a time of great despair also. And, you know, I need strong faith. So I hope someone comes across this. I'll start posting these on Facebook. And, you know, too many depressed comedians, too many comics killing themselves. And so I say, Merlin's looking for crumbs from the cookie I ate before. I say, I can share with you that, yes, faith has saved my behind, man. Faith has kept me going. It is a powerful, I've explained this time and again, a powerful, powerful force. Now, I saw on Facebook, there's a lot of, I'm friends with all different kinds of people on Facebook. I'm friends with a certain group, certain contingent of people that are very big on the Bible and very big on religion and the Bible literally and whatever. And some of these people really don't like the smiling minister, the smiling pastor, Joel Osteen, who basically really helped me at the time of greatest despair. And I didn't respond to their things. They think he's a televangelist and all he wants is money. The thing is, if they ever watched him, he never asked for money on his Sunday shows. He never asked for money. He's written like 7 bestsellers. That's where he has his money from. The ministry does incredibly good work worldwide and locally in Houston and here in the States, helping inner city kids, poor kids, It's an he's an amazing man, and it's an amazing ministry, and it does really good work. And it was disheartening to see these people who are Christians and believe in God really disparaging this man. This is not Benny Hinn. This is not Jimmy Swaggart. This is not Jimmy Baker or Tammy Faye. You know, this is not one of those televangelists. That's not who he is or what he is. And it's not a phony pearly white smile. This guy just happens to have taken care of himself his whole life. He was an athlete. He had a great dad. His dad was the original pastor of the church. He got the Compaq Center to be their church. And I'm saying all this because the guy deserves to be defended against anyone that speaks against him. Particularly for me, I feel like I need to defend him because he came to my aid. He came to my aid, man. I blew it. I mean, I blew it. I was done. I had had enough. And I saw Drew Carey talking about what took him away from wanting to kill himself. This is before he was famous. This was on Larry King. I never forget that interview. He said he read all the positive books, all the personal development books, and he said, and I thought, okay, you know, I'll do that. You know, I'll go do that again. And that's when I stumbled across Joel Osteen, and I didn't really need to read any positive books anymore. I mean, for now, I just needed to listen to this guy. This guy lifted my spirits tremendously. They also said that he didn't speak about Jesus, and they were all upset on the Facebook posts about how he never mentioned Jesus. That's just wrong. That told me they never watch him, because he mentions Jesus all the time, and I'm not a Jesus freak. And I have come to understand, I do have an ex-friend, a former friend, who I didn't stop being friends with him because of his Jesus love and his Jesus spreading of the word. It was another event that he just showed me he had no loyalty. And if you don't have loyalty, you know, you're not going to be a friend of mine. You know, I might know you, but you'll never someone I'll think of as a friend or someone I would trust implicitly. I'm looking for people I can trust implicitly. And but I did come to an understanding about why people do spread the word. Or even in social situations, which is what this guy would do. Because there's some passage about if you won't witness to me in front of others, how can you expect the Father to believe that you believe? Or there's something that says, go out and tell the people about Jesus, you know? And I am not a proselytizer. I just want to share experiences that helped me and benefited me. But you know what? When you're at the depths of despair, it was one guy that posted on Facebook about how he was thinking about blowing his brains out. And I wrote some of the quotes from Joel Osteen. And I wrote a quote I was given by a psychologist who visited the prisons. And this was, he told me once, Howie, God is real. And I shared that with this guy because I said, the last guy I didn't pay enough attention to, and it's not my fault. I don't have any guilt over this. I didn't know the guy who was a Facebook friend. But I hadn't seen any posts. He had been putting up these alarming posts, and I'd keep saying, keep the faith, you know, there will be a new day. A couple of months went by, then I go and I check his page, and it's pictures of friends of his at his memorial service. He hung himself. So when this guy that I kind of know a little, we actually spoke on the phone once, put this thing about blowing his brains out, I said, you know what, I'm not going to sit idly by. I'm going to tell you right now, you need to give it up to God. That's what I said. If you're in that kind of despair, you need to give it up to God. And a lot of comedians are atheists. I think fair amount. They're really down on religion, that much I know. Where they stand spiritually, I'm not sure. But I didn't really get a response from him. But the next day, many people commented. He said, I'm not writing this to look for pity or support. Or, you know, it's like, yeah, you're writing it to get some attention, and that's okay if you're in that state of mind. And the next day he goes, you know, I'm okay. It's a new day, whatever. But no matter where I stood right now, with my personal experience that brought me here, let's say I'd never had profound spiritual experiences with psilocybin mushrooms, and I never discovered the Course in Miracles, and I never discovered Joel Osteen. If I found myself in a state of mind where I was so downtrodden, in such despair, so ready to give up, I can't imagine that before I did, I wouldn't turn to God, even if I was a raging atheist. I just think, I don't know what happened to Robin Williams. I don't know if nobody really knows. I think some close to him might really know. But I would just think that if you're in that kind of despair, you'd go, okay, God, before I do it, I'll try you. I served Smokey Robinson dinner when I first came out from New York in Santa Barbara at the San Ysidro Ranch. Smokey Robinson, man. I was fresh out of Bayside, Queens, New York. Smokey Robinson, this is like a deity, man. He's legendary. And he wore a necklace. I never forgot it. And it said, choose God. So you know, if it's good enough for Smokey, you know, arguably the greatest writer of love songs of our generation, one of the greatest singer-songwriters, rockers. I mean, he's amazing. And I've met him two other times since, and he was just, he's just the sweetest, calmest guy. And that's what he had. He chose God. And I'm like, you know what? Good enough for Smokey, good enough for me. Good enough for a lot of these athletes that collect their awards to get their Super Bowl trophy. The first thing they do is they thank, I want to thank my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And they thank their mama. And, you know, even at the ESPY Awards, Alec Baldwin was cool enough to get down and Tebow with Tim Tebow. You know, and he's no lover of Jesus or Christianity. So I just want to say all that stuff's helped me. And people can mock it all day long and get all politically correct about, you know, they think if you're a Christian, you hate homosexuals. I don't know. The Christians I know are righteous and good people and have come to my aid in a big, big way. And a few of my fellow Jews, and I'm not an observant Jew, that's who's come to my aid. So they've strengthened my faith. And I just will say to anyone, if you're in just great despair and you're so downtrodden and so beat down by what you've put yourself through in life. And by the way, make sure you understand, you're responsible. You created your whole reality wherever you've been. You know, you created it. So if you're that downtrodden from it and you don't know how to turn it around, you know, what the heck at this point, if it's so bad, why not, you know, give God a try? You know, give faith a try. Call out to Jesus. You know, ask for his help. I mean, honestly, I was so cooked and done. Even my friends don't really understand how bad it was. Because, like I say, I live beyond my means. This is all financial-based stuff. Manage your money well. And, you know, we just did Pitbull Comedy and Music Jam with Sarah Amami. And her thing is she wants everybody to all be in love. And she said, you know, kindness is free. Spread that stuff around, man. Be kind. And I have to agree. I try, and I'm a guy on edge, you know. But I do my best to be kind, and help people where I can. And somebody told me the best way you praise God is by being helpful. And then there were those that believe, as I do, that, you know, dog spelled backwards is God, and that says a lot. And Merlin says that is correct. Look at that face. How can you look at that face and tell me there isn't a God? Come on now. Who can look at that? Tell me there isn't a God. Oh. Mm-hmm. All right. Anyway, I just wanted to state that. So all actors watching this, any actor watching this, exempt. When you're filling out W-4s, you're exempt from federal withholding. But know this. At the end of the year, don't do your own taxes. Get a good accountant and go to town with all the write-offs. Because if they feel you owe them money from that job, they will add penalties onto it because they believe they should have gotten the money that day. So you just got to know what you're dealing with. But if you don't put exempt, you're getting screwed. You can always send quarterly taxes. But if you need that money now, you'd better write exempt. Okay, so have faith that your acting career is going to come around. Play Carlos Santana in the morning when you wake up. Everything's coming our way. Listen to You Only Get What You Give. It's a brilliant song. And make a firm and conscious decision that good things are going to happen and expect it. Okay, have a great, great day. Thank you for watching.
Open your eyes, let it begin with me. Brand new day, fresh new way to live. The morning is calling. Walk with me unto the sun. Everything is coming. It's coming our way.